morning. Welcome to our service here in Glendermott today. And if you're visiting with us, bid you a very special welcome. And again, those by means of YouTube, DVD and CD, if you're joining us by those means, again, we're delighted to have you. We have a sacrament of baptism today, the second child of Taylor and Rebecca Cole. Little girl this time, sister of Cody. Most of you would know Cody, the wee blonde bombshell that runs up and down the church there. So, Cody. Oh, he doesn't, he's not listening to me. Oh, I'll not say nothing about sweeties, so he'll be running after me. So we're delighted to have the friends and family of Cody and the little sister and the Cole and Chambers extended family and friends. Our food share is available in the hall after the service, and if your husband didn't buy you flowers this week, now's a chance to get a bunch for yourself, because there's plenty of flowers over there today. Tea and coffee is available in the hall after the church as well. We have a committee meeting, congregational committee meeting, on the 31st of January at 7:30 p.m. in the upper hall. The word today for today is available. It's the spring edition, believe it or not. After last week, it's hard to believe that they're talking about it being the spring edition, February, March and April. So the word for today is available in the vestibules, porches and the way out. PW out into the Millennium Forum on the 29th of March at 8 p.m. And again, contact Avril Hyman if you wish to go, or again, if you have money to pay for tickets. There's a note on the back of the announcement sheet there again about the Smile Foundation trip that I talked about last week. So speak to Holly and Andrew Keane if you're interested in that, or can do anything to help with the products that are coming there that they need to go out to Romania. And the Curling Club is starting again. Probably one of the last organisations to start up again, but the Curling Club starting on Wednesday at 11 o'clock in the Upper Hall. So if you want to give it a go, or if you've been there before and enjoyed it, you'll be welcome back to that. So Curling Club, Upper Hall, Wednesday at 11 o'clock. The flowers today have been put on by David and Heather Glenn. And again, our Boys Brigade Company, we mentioned them last week, they've done well again. The BB Battalion Company Section Football Tournament, which in my time in BB was always a very hotly sort of contested event, but our under 14s come second. They got to the final and come second, and the over 15s, they made the semi-finals of that competition. So again, congratulations to our BB company for that. That is all the announcements. Thank you.
Thank you, George. Good morning, folks. It's good to see you all out this morning, as George says. One of my sayings that I haven't said it in a while, because George does the announcements. Whether you're here all the time, the odd time, or this is your first time with us, it's good to have you with us. And we do trust we will know God's blessing as we meet together this morning. I have one other thing I want to mention. The older end of our young people will hopefully have received one of these on the way in. You will know halfway through our service, our young people go out to creche and the children's church. Now that's primarily aimed for sort of P1 to P7. So if you're above that age and you're staying in and you find yourself falling asleep as the minister's talking during the sermon and so on, you might want one of these even if you're a bit older, if you find yourself falling asleep. But there are little sheets now produced for that older end of the age group who will stay with us, sort of year 8 upwards. Just little worship service notes. What's the Bible passage? What was your favourite song? A wee bit about what did the minister say? What did it mean to me? Just something to keep you focused. And say it might be useful to some of the older people as well. But if you haven't received one of these on the way in, if you see Ruth down the back as the younger ones leave for Children's Church, I'm sure Ruth will be able to sort you out with one. Just a little thing I want to trial just to give you, rather than drawing cartoons in the back of the Bible or something like that there, these are available. So please make use of them. They'll be available every week. Hopefully you will find them useful for you. As we come to worship, we're going to stand. You'll have heard the praise group playing. It's good to have Mark Choir and praise group, the whole shebang, as they talk about up the front this morning. We're going to be singing He is Lord and then into Jesus is Lord. So I thought it would be appropriate to read. I know it's not that long since we looked at this passage, but Philippians 2, where we see this mindset of Jesus, and I think that's where we looked at it the last time, but I think it's an apt passage to read as we come to worship today. And Paul, writing to the church in Philippi, and of course to us, says this: in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing, by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Let's stand and sing these two pieces of praise together. He is Lord, and then Jesus is Lord. Let's stand and let's worship God together.
Thank you.
Let's, as always, continue in our worship. Let's commit our time of God to Him in prayer. Let's pray together. Let's pray. Father, it is a wonderful thing to come and to sing our songs of praise and worship to You. We thank You for this awesome privilege it is to gather as Your people and, yes, to sing and sing out loud that Jesus is Lord. Lord, over everything in this earth, You are that one true Almighty God. And, Lord, surely that stirs our hearts even as we sing our songs here this morning. But yet, Father, as those words of praise, as those majestic words of Your power over all things fall silent from our lips, Lord, we have to confess that, Lord, it is so easy for us to come and to gather in this place and to sing and to proclaim Your name. And yet, as we've been thinking about over the past few weeks, it's so easy for us to, from a Monday to a Saturday, that our lives say something completely different. Lord, You've called us to be set apart to proclaim Your goodness, Your grace, Your mercy, to proclaim the gospel to the world around us. And yet, we confess how often we fail You, that as we go about our day-to-day business, as we interact with those out in the world, so often we're found no different to those around us. That our profession of faith says nothing to the world around us. But Father, we thank You that even though we know we fall so short sometimes, we thank You that You are, yes, that all-powerful, that almighty God, but You are that loving, forgiving God as well. And when we come and we humble ourselves before You and we seek Your forgiveness, Lord, we know that we can enjoy that restored relationship with You. And Lord, we just pray today for each of us, Lord, as we prepare ourselves to face whatever the week ahead of us has in store for us, whatever You have planned in Your purposes for us in Your world, Lord, we pray that You would enthuse us in this time. Lord, may we go leaving this place, not just rejoicing here, but go out into the world rejoicing and proclaiming that You are Lord and You deserve all the praise, honor, and glory for who You are and what You've done. So, Lord, will You bless our time together? Lord, as we meet, as we turn to Your word, as we think about Your word, will You speak to us? Help us and empower us to serve You in Your world, in this, our time and our generation, in this little corner of Your vineyard here in Glendermott. Bless us in this time, we pray, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I'm going to turn to God's Word together now. If you want to lift one of the pew Bibles, there are two readings today, actually. We know both of the readings very well. They will be coming up on the screen as well. But the first, I want to read from Hebrews chapter 10, and verses 19 to 25, and then turn just to Exodus chapter 20, to the Ten Commandments, and that's the first. Hebrews 10 is found on page 1208 of the Pew Bible, and the Exodus passage is on page 78, but it is, as I say, on the screen as well. Let me read it for you. This is God's Word. Let's hear it to us today. Hebrews chapter 10, and actually reading from verse 19. Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened up for us, through the curtain, that is, His body. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for He who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. If we deliberately keep on sinning after we have received the knowledge of truth, no sacrifice for sins is left, but only a fearful expectation of judgment and of raging fire that will consume the enemies of God. Then to Exodus chapter 20, and reading from verse 8 to 11, just a reminder of the commandment to do with the Sabbath day. God says, remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or daughter, nor your manservant or maidservant, nor your animals, nor the alien within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Amen. We thank God for his word, and as we think a little bit about that later on, we do trust that God will speak to us through that. But as George said, it is a wonderful thing to be able to come and to celebrate the sacrament of baptism once again with Taylor and Rebecca. So we're going to stand and we're going to sing the first two verses of our baptismal hymn, Our Children, Lord, in Faith and Prayer We Bring Before Your Face. Just take a seat for a moment or two. My apologies for the computer error there. I'm assuming it's something I have done when I was putting it all together, but I think we should know the words of it well enough by now. But it is good. It's really good to be here to help celebrate, of course, this important and significant day for Taylor and Rebecca once again and their family as we celebrate this wonderful and meaningful sacrament of baptism together. As I often say, it's always wonderful to be part of such a significant day in the life of their family, and of course of the wider church family too. It is a significant time for us as God's family here too. But there is always that danger as we are involved in the likes of this sacrament. There's always the danger that we fall into so that trap of treating it in some kind of blasé religious ceremony where in effect it almost becomes meaningless. So it is important, as always, to remind ourselves of how important and how significant this sacrament is. I remember saying once before about an article I had read about baptism, and strangely enough it referred to that same theme about treating baptism in a sort of blasé and religious manner and losing the significance of what baptism is. And we end up focusing more on the outward celebration of this special day rather than the inward reality that it is. Of course, the article said this. It said that too often parents had their infants, haul their infants to the front of the church for the feel-good Kodak moment. I don't know if you remember me saying that before. It's all about the pictures where the baby is cute, where the baptism is performed, and we applaud and we congratulate the family. But of course, baptism, yes, it is a celebration, but it is a celebration of the power of the gospel. It's a celebration pointing us to Christ and his work for our salvation. The water points us to the cleansing or washing of our sin, and our profession of faith points us heavenward to our dependence on God and our faith and trust in him. Now, as we always mention, it does place a huge responsibility on the parents, of course, but also on us as a fellowship to help the parents in the spiritual upbringing of their children. Parents promise to bring up the child in the ways and the teaching of the church. And of course, we as God's family here too must play our part in helping and encouraging the parents with that awesome task, because that's what it is. It is an awesome task. And of course, one of the ways we do that as a fellowship is to seek to provide help in the teaching of all that for them. Whilst the primary onus is, of course, on the parents, as the family of God here, we provide teaching and guidance as well. In the likes of our creche, we've mentioned it, our Sunday school classes, our children's church, and, well, the new worksheets I mentioned earlier for the young folk who stay with us during the service. All designed by the church to help parents bring up their children within the fellowship here. There's lots going on to help the parents during the week, BB and GB and so on. And we all have a part to play in that. We will all stand alongside the parents. We will all make a promise to God to help them and play our part in bringing up their children in the teaching of the church. But the parents, of course, do have the ultimate and most important part to play. The primary responsibility is placed on the parents to live up to the vows and promises that they make to God. And so, as we come to the vows and promises, I'm going to read the short declaration that I always do that reminds us of our responsibility as we make our particular promises to him. So can I ask you, as a fellowship and the family of God here, to stand with us and stand with these parents as we come to the vows of commitment. So, as I say, primarily to you, Taylor and Rebecca, but to us all, because we all make the promise. I solemnly charge you now in the presence of God and of this congregation that in answering these questions, you do so with honesty and sincerity. For be assured that the blessing of God only rests upon those who so promise and then fulfill, whereas the wrath of God is the portion of those who promise lightly or thoughtlessly and neglect to fulfill their solemn obligations to him. Of course, in simple terms, what does that mean? We make a promise to God, and if we expect God's blessing, then we must live up to the promises we have made. And of course, if we don't, there are consequences. Isn't that right? So, first of all, to you, Taylor and Rebecca, in presenting this child for baptism, are you affirming your belief in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Are you trusting in Jesus Christ alone as your Savior from sin and as Lord of your life? And depending on the grace of God, are you committed to living as a follower of Jesus Christ, led and empowered by the Holy Spirit? And are you willing to provide a Christian home and bring up your child in the worship and teaching of this church, so that she may come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior? And to you, the congregation, as we receive Ruby into the fellowship of this church, do you promise with God's help to be faithful in prayer, spiritual nurture, Christian example and influence for her and her family? Now the fun part. How are you feeling today? Oh, I know that feeling very well. Oh dear, 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 dear. There we go. You're not like your mum, you're being good. There we go. Ruby Avril Cole, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. This child is now received according to Christ's command into the membership of the Holy Universal and Apostolic Church and is engaged to be the Lord's. Let's sing the words of the Aaronic blessing together. Let's just pray together. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the wonder of this sacrament. We thank you for how deep a spiritual significance it has for us and the importance it has for Taylor and Rebecca as Ruby's parents and for us as a family of God here. Lord, we thank you that it is a sacrament which points us to you and to your saving grace in each of our lives. And Lord, we do pray, as we have said, that Ruby will grow up to know you and to love you as Lord and Savior in your time. Lord, we pray that that would be the case. And as always, we pray for each and every one of us. We pray for all our families. We pray, Lord, that you would be known in each of our families, that your word would be spoken easily within our homes. And Lord, help us to teach our children your ways. Lord, as a fellowship to you, we thank you for all that does happen here to help our children grow up in your ways. And Lord, we pray that you would help us all play our part in that endeavor. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Ruby, you and I are going to go for a wee walk, as we always do. I can't believe how much you look like your big brother. You're like a twin. That's a good thing. We're going to sing the closing two verses of our baptismal hymn, and Ruby and I will take a wee walk around, will we? Yeah? Okay. Days like this, we talk about the importance of bringing our children up in the teaching of the church. So one of the things we do is to give you a little Bible for Ruby to And we do trust that in the days that lie ahead, you will take time to read it to her. And your little baptismal certificate is there as well. Well done for being so good. We're going to continue worshiping God together now as we respond to God's goodness to us as your morning offering is now taken up. Father, we do thank you for your goodness. Lord, we thank you once again that we've been able to celebrate this sacrament of baptism, which points us to your goodness and grace. It points us to the glory of the gospel. And Lord, in response to that, we bring our offering to you today. Lord, we pray you would bless it, that you would use it for your glory and that of your Son and our Savior, the Lord Jesus himself. Amen. To continue in worship together now as we stand and sing our next piece of praise as we prepare ourselves to turn to God's word. O great God of highest heaven, occupy my lowly heart. Let's stand and let's worship God together.
Thank you.
Let's just pray together as we turn to God's word. Father, we thank you for your word to us, Lord, as we pause in a sense now in the middle of our service, Lord, to take time to focus on what you would have to say to us. Lord, we pray that you would clear our minds and open our hearts that we might hear your still, small voice speaking to us. Lord, may the words of our mouths be yours and that we might hear you clearly today. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We are into our fourth week now, thinking about this topic of being set apart as a church, about how we need to have a different attitude to the things of life. And of course, that is right and proper. We think about the things that make us stand out from society. And we need to do that if we're going to impact that society for the gospel. If you remember the book I mentioned that we're using and thinking about from Kent Hughes was Set Apart, Calling a Worldly Church to a Godly Life. And isn't that where we so often struggle? Living that godly life in the worldly perspective. So often, as we've already confessed today, we just blend in and simply do the same as everyone else. Our lives are virtually indistinguishable from the people around us who haven't yet come to faith in Christ. We've noticed we have the same problem of materialism as everyone else. We have the same desire for the pleasures of life that everyone else has. And yes, truth be told, we often pursue them with the same vigor, just like everyone else. I think it's safe to say that we'd all have to confess that we're far too easily distracted by those worldly things. And of course, the offshoot of that is that we lose sight of God himself. And of course, we've also recognized the real and present danger of that. Because a lot of what occupies our thoughts and our lives is of no eternal value whatsoever. If you remember the man last week from Ecclesiastes who reckoned that he was greater than anyone else because he'd amassed all this silver and gold, these slaves and singers, the vineyards, the orchards, the livestock and all. He held back no pleasure from himself. He denied nothing. He took everything that was going, only to realize at the end of it all, it didn't mean a thing. It was chasing, like chasing the wind, as he put it. And the challenge we've been pondering, I guess, is how prevalent that attitude is in so many professing Christians these days. The world and all its temptations have had a profound of impact on the folk in the church, haven't they? And we haven't had that light bulb moment like the writer from Ecclesiastes to realize that it's all of no use whatsoever. And as we say, what might be even worse than not realizing that these things are of no eternal value, we've lost sight of what is. We've lost sight of some of the things that should be central to who we are and the impact that can have on the world around us. Let me come back to my friend from the ski group, John, as we called him last week. If you remember, he mentioned and he told me that he was a believer, but they didn't go to church. And remember, we've said that if the only difference between an unbeliever and a believer was the fact that they went to church, why would they see any reason to listen to us? Never mind join us. Then John's case is even worse, isn't it? If people looked at him and seeing that attending church isn't important enough for him to be even bothered to go, why would it be important for them to go? So that's what I want to think about for a moment or two this week. I want us to think about church and the problem of church and being set apart from the world. Because like the things of the world, our attitude to other things, like the church, of course can have a profound impact on those around us. Because you see, it's not just a problem for John, is it? John not going to church isn't, he's not on his own, is he? It's a widespread problem in most churches these days. If you ever get a look at the little graph of church membership and attendance figures in that little infamous blue book that comes out with all the reports from General Assembly, well, I'm sure you've a fair idea where the graph is going. It's down and down and down and down all the time. And it's not just us. Like we said, it's a problem in every denomination. Church just doesn't seem to be central to even a lot of believers' lives nowadays. So again, why would it be important to unbelievers? To the world out there, the church, the idea of church is outdated, it's old-fashioned, it's irrelevant. And sad to say, some of that mindset has begun to creep into the minds of believers as well. The very first presbytery consultation of a congregation that I was ever involved in, they used a word about church attendance that, well, I think it could be used for nearly every church in this land, if not the world. And that word was sporadic. Attendance was sporadic. Now, by and large, yes, we're very good here. We're probably one of the best attended congregations in the presbytery here. So congratulations again for being above the normal trends and the statistics. But you know, in many aspects, we do suffer the same as everyone else. There are folk you might see for 3 or 4 weeks in a row, and then you'll not see them for another 2 or 3 weeks, or maybe even longer. And there appears to be no rhyme or reason to it or pattern to it. Ach, it's a lovely day, so we'll not bother going. Or, ach, it's a horrible day, so we'll just stay in the house. Ach, sure, I'll be up on YouTube or Facebook later on. We'll get around to watching it sometime later in the week. Which, of course, they never do. I think it's sad to say that there are plenty of Johns out there who profess to be believers, who profess to belong to churches, but you seldom or never see them at worship. I know I've used the analogy from an article I read a while back in conversation with a few of you before. It's the one that describes, I think, a lot of folk who are attached to our churches. And it said that our churches are filled with CEO Christians. And we don't mean the chief executive officers, but Christmas and Easter only Christians. And especially when we're thinking about the church being set apart to save and about the impact it can have in our communities to point others to Jesus. Would we not be right in saying then, without a doubt, if that's the attitude we have, we're failing in one of the most primary purposes that God has set us apart for in the first place. An interesting conversation a number of years ago while visiting a lady one time, and she was telling me about talking with a man about church and religion and so on. And the interesting thing, and I think it's a really sad indictment of our church, was the interesting thing, the man said that he was a Catholic on a Saturday, but a Protestant on a Sunday. Yeah, I can see the minds going. It's confusing. But he said he was a Catholic on a Saturday because he could go to church on a Saturday evening, but he was a Protestant on a Sunday because then he could lie in bed at 4 o'clock and didn't have to go to church. But if that's what people are thinking but our churches, what does it say about our God? That's a far cry from what Scripture says about the church and its purpose, isn't it? You're a chosen people, Scripture says. A royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession. That you may declare the praises of Him who called you out of darkness into His wonderful light. In reality, The attitude of many professing Christians sadly declares nothing about their God and their Savior. So the call or the command from God is about the importance of being part of a visible fellowship of God's people. That's why we read the passages we did. That's the call of Scripture. We should be part of a visible fellowship of God's people. Unfortunately, that article that I read about the CEO Christians had something very different to say. It said there are millions of professing followers of Jesus Christ who are churchless Christians. They go to no church, they assemble with no fellowship, they worship at no location, and they lead no souls to Christ. That's a sad indictment of the church, isn't it? They go to no church, they assemble with no fellowship, they worship at no location, and they lead no souls to Christ. I think we're failing in our primary purpose, aren't we? In Hughes' book as well, he gives a number of types of Christians that I think are interesting as well. I'll not give you them all. If you want to get the book, read them all. But there are some I think are worthy of note and some that we'll probably recognize very easily. There are those we've mentioned already, what he calls the churchless Christians. You know the mentality. I don't need a church. I can worship God in the coffee shop or in the golf course or wherever. And now in these days, that can include the YouTube Christians as well, can't it? Those who say they don't need to go to church. We get church online. And of course, part of that is true. We can worship God anywhere. And YouTube and Facebook are great. But they are no substitute. The churchless and the YouTube Christian are missing out on so much more. The fellowship, the friendship, the support, the encouragement and so on. All those things that Scripture commends to us as a vital part of our lives as His family. The churchless Christian. Then he talks about the drive-through Christian. We all love a drive-through, don't we? We love the convenience of driving through for a quick fix of the, well, whatever your fancy is, it should be a big greasy McDonald's burger or whatever it is. We all like just to drive through and be handed it and drive away again. But it's that CEO Christian mentality again, isn't it? Where church is just that quick fix. It's just for now and again. It's just for Christmas and Easter or the odd Sunday here and there. Sure, we'll go a couple of times a year and that'll do us. We'll be all right, sure. The drive-through Christian. Then he talks about two types of money-orientated Christian, which I think we can find in all churches. The hitchhiker Christian and the consumer Christian. The hitchhiker is the one who won't commit to the likes of full membership. They don't give proportionately to the free will offering if they do at all. It's your job. You pay the bills, do all the work. I'll come along for the ride. But you know, if things don't suit me, I'll soon let you know. I'll criticize and I'll complain. And if you don't do what I want, then I'll hitch a ride to another church. We've all seen them, haven't we? The hitchhiker Christian. The consumer Christian is very similar. Although they are the ones with, well, let's call it a provisional loyalty to the church, if we could use it that way. They do commit in a way. They'll give to the free will offering and so on, but on the provision that since I paid for it, you'll do the things I want. And if you don't, well, I'm off with the hitchhiker Christian, I'll take my business elsewhere. You get the picture, don't you? But that's not what the family and fellowship of God's people is supposed to be like. We have to realize how crucial the church is. especially when we consider the call to live a godly life that points others to the joy of salvation and the joy of fellowship with God and with his family. We all know that it's a command from Scripture. We've just read it. We're to meet together for worship. We're to encourage each other. We're to help each other as we seek to live for Christ in this ungodly and self-focused world. It's there. It's biblical. The likes of Luther and Calvin warned against those who neglect the visible church. They simply couldn't conceive life without the church. They couldn't conceive life without meeting together with other Christians in fellowship and encouragement. Yes, salvation for Calvin was personal, but never individualistic. We're redeemed, we're saved to be members of a body, the body of Christ, the church, God's family. Scripture is full of so many wonderful images of the church. Christ's body, his temple, his bride, his sheep, his family, his children, the place of fellowship and nurture and the likes. All these heartwarming and heart-stirring images. Friends, we are part of the greatest institution the universe has ever known. This kind of careless or cavalier attitude of neglect of such a wonderful doctrine like that is odd, to say the least. Certainly, if our hearts have been truly converted and we're born again through faith in Christ. Because if we are, and we neglect things that are a scriptural command, it's plain and simple disobedience at the very least, isn't it? We need the church. We need the collective people of God to grow and to flourish and to fulfill the task God has given us in this world. Friends, I love the church. I love being part of the church family. I know I can't do without it. And I know there are many of you who feel the same. And it warms my heart to see folk who love the church like that. Warms my heart to see folk growing in their relationship with God and in their fellowship with each other, because it is scriptural. But of course, there's a challenge for a lot of other folk as well. Where is the church's place in your list of priorities in life? Have the consumerism and hedonistic ideals of worldly life risen above church in your priority list and become more important than it? Is going for a wee walk on the beach or the forest park on a Sunday more important than meeting with God's people in fellowship and worship of him? Is the dirty big nuts galore ice cream from Morelli's in Port Stewart on a summer day more important than meeting with God's family to worship? Do you think it's okay or appropriate to neglect the fellowship and witness of the church in favor of YouTube and Facebook? Because it's not. Friends, we need to resist this consumeristic, hitchhiking, churchless mentality and commit ourselves to this wonderful local expression of Christ's body. We need to commit ourselves fully to the building up of the body through our prayer, service, time, and stewardship, and all those things. We need to commit our time and our lives around the life of the church instead of our individual pursuits and pleasures. You get the common thread. It's commitment. I know we live in a day and an age that doesn't like that word commitment. But we are to be committed to Christ and to his family. We need to show the world that this actually means something to us. if we love Jesus the way we say we do, how can we not love and want to be part of the family and fellowship that he's created for us? If we love Jesus the way we say we do, how can we neglect the very thing that he gave his life for? Friends, being part of the family and fellowship of God's people is fundamental to who we are and what we're called to do. Committing ourselves to the life and witness of the church is what sets us apart. It helps us to stand out and to stand up. And of course, as our scripture reading reminded us, those who neglect it, just like those who love materialism and hedonism, do so at the detriment of their eternal souls. So friend, here's the challenge of what I said at the start. It's great, it's wonderful if you're here all the time. It's good to have you the odd time, and it's brilliant to have you here for the first time. But the call and the command of Scripture is to gather with God's people all the time. Let's commit ourselves to building God's church and in turn building his kingdom as we stand out as a witness to him in this little corner of his vineyard that he has blessed and called Glendermott. Let's commit ourselves to being full members of his family here. Let me pray with you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your salvation, first and foremost, that draws us into your family. But Lord, we recognize that that has implications on our lives. It makes us part of something bigger and something far greater than we could ever imagine. Makes us part of your heavenly family. And yet, as we've recognized, like a lot of these things, like consumerism and hedonism and all the rest, and materialism and the things of the world, far too easily draw us away from something so magnificent as your family. We pray that you would help us to commit ourselves to coming together to strengthen each other, to encourage each other, and yes, to witness for you in our world. And yes, we recognize the challenge for those, yes, maybe listening to this service on CD or YouTube or Facebook, or that whilst that's good and useful, when we can't, for various reasons, just quite make it here, that it is no substitute for coming and enjoying the fellowship of your people. Lord, will you use this reminder, this challenge even, to draw folk back here to your place of worship, that we might shine here in this valley, that we might shine and proclaim something of your goodness and grace to those around us, that they too might know the joy of salvation and the joy of fellowship with you and with your people. So challenge us, speak to us, each one, we pray, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're going to close with our last hymn, Great is the Darkness, and of course it's a hymn which reminds us of the darkness that is out in the world. It covers the earth, as the words say there, the oppression, the injustice, and the pain, and so on. But of course, I think it's the second verse that talks about, may now your church rise with power. Let us rise with power in this dark world and shine as stars for Jesus. Let's worship God together. just pray as we close. Father, we thank you for this time of worship. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to gather, to sing our praises, to glorify you through all that we do here. Lord, as we go across for a time of fellowship together in the hall, as we enjoy a cup of tea and a conversation, we pray that you would bless that time that we spend together. Lord, build us up, encourage us, help us to build each other up and to encourage each other as we seek to live for you in this dark world that we do in these days. But we pray that as we part, that the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit would go with each of us, both now and forevermore. Amen.